Hello, all. Thanks for joining us for this edition of what I'm calling the Winterset Questionnaire, in which I put a series of questions to the finalists for the 2020 BMO Winterset Award, celebrating excellence in Newfoundland and Labrador writing. So my guest on the screen is right now is Bridget Canning. Hello.
Hi, Jamie.
Bridget is nominated for the Winterset Award for her second novel. It's this one, Some People's Children. Joining her on this year's shortlist, in case you didn't already see it, Andrea Proctor, the author of A Long Journey, Residential Schools in Labrador and Newfoundland, and Eva Crocker for her debut novel, All I Ask. I'm also chatting with Eva and Andrea. You'll find those conversations here on the ArtsNL YouTube channel as well, so you can look for that. But let's check in with Bridget now. Thank you very much for joining me.
Oh, you're welcome. This is great.
Are you ready to grapple with the questionnaire?
I think so. I'll try my best.
All right.
I'll grapple with everything else. So there you go.
It's a format of six questions. And the first three pertain quite specifically to this novel, Some People's Children. Number one, if you had a chance to experience a scene or event that takes place in your book, what would you choose?
That's a good question. In the second half of the book, so the book starts in the late 80s, and it covers late 80s and early 90s. And there's a scene in the second part of the book where Imogene is reunited with this guy that she knew. She has this huge crush on this guy named Jamie. And there's a night that they're kind of meet up again, and they go to see a show at the Loft. And that was the Loft was in, it was Haymarket Square.
That's right.
I think it was this, and I remember going to shows there in the 90s, and I definitely wanted, you know, a moments from the, you know, the downtown music scene in the 90s in there. And so definitely if I was going to revisit something, I think that scene, because just for that moment to be in that place and that time, and also because it is a moment in the book where Imogene is kind of, this is you know, the spark of a new crush that she's developing. So I think to kind of be a fly on the wall there would be a lot of fun.
Partly to see how things develop in the story, but also partly for nostalgic reasons.
Exactly. Yeah. Just to go to the Loft one more time.
Number two, how would you describe your book to someone who's never going to get a chance to read it?
I would call it, I'm stealing a bit here from a review that somebody called the book, it's a coming of age story about someone coming to terms. So that's how I think I would describe it. I would say it's a coming of age story about a person where the protagonists realize that their life, what they know about themselves, is the product of gossip. So it's not just coming of age, but it's also kind of coming to terms with truth, like what is truth and what is not, and how much does it actually matter?
Okay. Third question, how has writing this book changed you, if you look back to where you were before you started and the person you are now?
It's changed me a bit. I would say it's definitely changed how I feel about how long it takes to write a story, how long it takes to write a novel. It's funny because this is actually my first book, but it wasn't the first book that got published. And my first book, The Greatest Hits of Wanda James, well, the first one that was published, I wrote that rather quickly. It kind of came to me. This book, I actually was going through a journal. One of my COVID projects was trying to gut out my office, and I have a wall, like a giant shelf of old journals, some of them that go back to high school. And I found one, and it was from 2000. There's actually pages in the journal where that are Some People's Children, that are, you know, notes and ideas and bits of dialogue and things like that. So, and I think what happened then is it was a book I kind of started and put down and picked up and put down, and I would get discouraged or, you know, talk myself out of it, you know, before trying to write a novel when you haven't, in that time of your life and you're kind of not even comfortable with calling yourself a writer. So I think what I've definitely learned from this is how don't throw anything away when it comes to writing, and don't feel, I think just, first drafts, they take as long as they have to. It was a question I think I've been asked a couple of times, like, how long do you think it takes to write a first draft? And I think that, I'm trying to work on something right now and I have most of a draft written, but another project comes my way. I put it down, I pick it up. So I think one thing to summarize, I would say it's taught me to, not worry too much about not to rush it, just basically not to give huge time constraints on myself, and to enjoy the kind of prospect of being able to pick it up and put it down and looking at something with fresh eyes.
So some of the material in this one, goes back a couple of decades.
Yeah. I was going through, and I hadn't really realized that. And I was going through the journals, like, oh my God, this is published now. This year that I was scribbling in an exercise book, in 2000. So, I guess basically, to answer that question, I know I'm not answering it very well. I'm rambling a lot here. But from writing this book, that basically, like I said, however long it takes.
Right.
I guess.
Okay, you get points for perseverance. I've got three more questions for you. These ones kind of go beyond the pages of your own book. We're going to talk a little bit more in a broader sense. And on that note, question number four is, what is the book that never leaves you, even though you might have read it a long time ago? What's the book that you feel always sticks with you?
There's definitely a number of books that have stuck with me over the years. I think one that never leaves me, it's a tie, it's between, and they're both books I read as a child, Harriet the Spy and Watership Down. And in Harriet the Spy, oh my God, I wrote down, that's terrible, the author's name has just completely left me. Harriet the Spy, she's always walking around with her notebook, and as someone who journals quite a bit, as I was just saying, that kind of the whole process of her kind of watching and observing and writing down things, and she's basically learning how to be a writer. She's learning how to observe life, and of course it gets her in trouble, and there's the whole her friends find her notebook and read it and read all the horrible things she's written, snarky little things that she's written about them, and bully her for that. So I would say that one, and also Watership Down, for the whole kind of mythology that's in that book with the rabbits, and like the way that they kind of, it's one of these things like, and I think that book stuck with me with that, as I said, their whole mythology, but just kind of the way that we, the way it combines, the way, rabbit actual behavior and things like that. And it kind of changed the way I looked at animals that we take for granted. Like we see crows every day, or we see, things like that. So I think it that book stayed with me because of the whole, I feel like I'm not used to talking. Anymore. It's like I have to learn how to talk. This is what the pandemic has done. We've all kind of we haven't been having enough lengthy chats. But definitely Watership Down, just for staying with the whole the idea that you can kind of make a story. The opportunities for metaphor that I guess were in that story, and how as the rabbits move around, they go into different places, and each different kind of warren is a metaphor for an aspect of human society. I think that one definitely sticks with me a lot.
Okay, two more. This is question number five. What is the moment in history you'd most like to witness?
I would like to, honestly, maybe it's because of the pandemic, I just really want to go to like a big concert, like Woodstock or something like that. I think it's also, I think partly because some of these things kind of get glamorized and there's a curiosity. I have a curiosity for kind of seeing how, you know, what it was actually like. I think I kind of would like to go, I guess Woodstock is glamorized, but I mean, obviously there's, everyone's kind of, you know, it also looks like it was, everyone just covered in filth, but,
right.
Yeah. Just to witness that, just for witness the highs and lows, literal highs and lows of that moment. I think, yeah, definitely.
Before the mythology took over, yeah.
Before it became this iconic moment that's very romanticized, yeah.
Final question for you, number 6. Where would all your creative energy go if you weren't writing?
It's a toss-up. Is gardening's creative, right?
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah, I would think it would go between, I really like cooking and I really like gardening. And I think probably somewhere with those things, like something where I can, I don't have good fine motor skills. So I really admire people who can do things like knit and embroider and do finicky little things. I am not that person. Every time I've picked up something like the name, I'm way too aware of the learning curve that I have with that. But I like things like cooking and I'm kind of just getting into gardening, like things that are kind of, well, we'll put this together and we'll see what happens. Maybe we can eat it. maybe it'll grow. I don't know. So something like that, I think. Yeah.
Maybe that's a good metaphor for writing as well. We'll put this together and maybe we can eat it.
Something nice will happen. Yeah.
Okay, you are done. That's Bridget Canning. I tried to stump her with the Winterset questionnaire, but wasn't able to. Well done by you.
All right, thanks, Jamie. That's great. Sorry, I rambled so much for worship. Damn, I couldn't get my. I was like, I cannot get my thoughts collected about this at all. Anyway,
it must be a COVID thing.
Yeah.
Well, like I mentioned before, the other two Winterset finalists have also done a version of this questionnaire with me. That's Andrea Proctor and Eva Crocker. And you'll find those videos here on the ArtsNL YouTube channel. And what you really want to find and read are the 3 shortlisted books for the 2020 BMO Winterset Award, Celebrating Excellence in Newfoundland and Labrador Writing. They are Some People's Children by Bridget Canning, who's with me at the moment, All I Ask by Eva Crocker, and A Long Journey by Andrea Proctor. Thanks for doing this today, Bridget.
You're welcome. It was great.
And thank you all for tuning in.